Hey guys, it's Eric with the Film Photography Channel. Let's take a look at the Rollei 35S. This is the Rollei. Rollei is the proper pronunciation. We say Rollei. This is the 35S. It is a collapsible fixed lens, as you can see here. This is one of those lenses that falls into the body, and I'll show you more on that in a second. Fixed lens viewfinder camera, not a rangefinder, because Rollei couldn't quite figure out how to make a rangefinder work. The camera was produced from 1966 to 1970 in Germany, and in 1970 they moved production to Singapore just to move it back to Germany in 1981. This is a 35S, which means it has a sonar lens, and it has the meter, match needle meter on top. Okay, the 35SE would have a E for electronic meter inside the viewfinder, a series of LEDs that just tell you exposure high or low, but also having the sonar lens, which is a 5-element, super sharp, very nice Zeiss licensed lens, which they licensed to Rollei. The other models in the line are going to be the 35T, which is a Tessar lens. TE would be the Tessar lens electronic, exposure meter, in terms of the LEDs in the viewfinder. All right, so they're all basically the same. And there was a Triotar lens also. It sounded like a 3-element lens. I don't know a lot about that. I think that was one of the first versions or something. I don't know. But the far and away, the most popular is going to be the 35S, 35T, and the TE and SE as well. All of the cameras have the same basic boxy shape, but as you can see, it's a pretty small shape. I mean, it fits right there in the palm of your hand. So it's a tiny little camera, but it's a camera that sold extremely well. And they sold over 2 million of these, and they had a bit of a cult following. So this is a tiny camera with big parts, all right? So it doesn't feel in operation, it doesn't really feel like a small camera with little tiny fiddly pieces, in terms of like the film advance and all the dials and the buttons and all that. Right here you have the f-stop, your f-stop ring, your f-stop adjustment, and you're required to push this little button in before you can turn the f-stop ring, which is nice because it kind of locks it in and you don't have to worry about accidentally changing your f-stop. Within the f-stop, there's two little nibbles here that can help you change the very clicky ISO setting. So here's your film speed right in the middle. This dial is your shutter speed dial, which you can see the shutter speed numbers right there from 1/2 second plus bulb all the way up to 1/500th of a second. And within that knob is your film reminder. Now this camera doesn't have a film reminder window, so it's nice that you can set something to remind yourself if it's black and white film, if it's color negative film, or what have you. The viewfinder is nice and big. It's a good enough viewfinder. It's not like a standard or anything like that, but it is about as big as a Leica viewfinder. It's just not as bright, and it doesn't have that fine optical glass, but it's fine. I mean, it's as good as you could expect for a small camera. It does have parallax correction lines in there as well, so it definitely does the job. Rollei tried to make this into a rangefinder camera. They may have even released some prototypes, but they never actually got a rangefinder into production. So this is definitely a camera that you just have to estimate the focus. Speaking of which, you have the very outside here is your focus dial, and it's nicely weighted. I mean, it's surprisingly well dampened for such a small camera. Usually these tiny cameras have just something that moves without any weighting whatsoever, and this is like perfectly weighted. If this were a video camera, this would be an excellent pull focus deal here. Keeping in the theme of a small camera with big parts, look at this big old film advance lever. It's every bit as big as like on a full-size SLR. There's your shutter release right here. It's got a nice positive leaf shutter sound, so it sounds about as good as any I guess. I think it's a Copal shutter in here too. All right, and very positive, you know, feel, even for the film advance. You can hear how clicky it is. And the film advance and everything, all the movement is just very, very precise. This button here is to collapse the lens. Now, the lens won't collapse, and I'll show you. Okay, I just took a photo. I didn't advance the film. The lens will not collapse without advancing the film. This button is to collapse the lens, but as you can see, it won't do anything. It won't collapse until such time as the shutter's cocked, the film's advanced, and then you can press this button, just a minor turn, and then the lens collapses into the body, and you can see how nice and low the profile is once you do that. The shutter is locked when the lens is collapsed, so it's pretty easy. You bring the lens back in, and a minor turn there, and it's locked back in. The lens won't collapse without pressing the button, so that's a pretty well thought out system there. So in any case, you're able to take your photo here, and you can, and it's kind of odd, but you get used to it very quickly. It's like you take the photo with your right hand, you're used to, okay, this is where I advance my film on most cameras, but on this camera you advance the film here and you take the photo there. But you see how naturally and how quickly you can get used to that? I mean, it's pretty intuitive, and it kind of makes the body work like a little bit bigger, if that makes any sense. It makes it feel like a bigger camera body because you're using it with two hands, if that makes any sense there. All right, the light meter cell, the CDS cell is, I think, what they ended up with after trying a different type of cell. The CDS cell is right here, which is really less than ideal. And on the different models, they moved it. I think the SE ended up with the light cell right here, which is a little better because you can see very easily your finger almost naturally goes right in front of the cell. And of course, as you look at that, it's going to affect the metering. You know, so they did good to move it here, but I mean, this is probably literally the worst place they could have put it. If you look at how you operate this camera, it's not terrible that it's there, because the way you operate this camera is like you look down at it, right? Not unlike a TLR, which is what Rollei obviously is famous for. On a TLR camera, you have knobs on the front of the body very similar to this, and what you do is you look down at the camera and then you adjust these knobs. And so in that case, it's good that the light meter is up top here, because when you're looking down at this camera to make your adjustments, you can really do everything but focus. When you look down, you adjust your shutter speed, you adjust your aperture, having already entered your ISO for whatever film you're using. It's a match needle system, so just take a look at how that works. Hold on, there we go. You see how you see how the needle moves as I change the shutter speed. It'll also move as I change the aperture. Just depends on what you want to adjust to get proper exposure. So anyway, what happens is that you're looking down at the camera to make your adjustments, and then you hold the camera up to your eye, obviously, to take the photo. So let's take a look at the rest of the body here. We'll take the little mini tripod off. Now, this is definitely a little different. As you can see, there's the hot shoes on the bottom. Your tripod, metal tripod socket, nice threaded solid tripod socket is right here. Embedded in that is the film counter window. And again, little camera, big parts. You've got the film rewind lever right here. It pops out, and you have a great film rewind. Am I going the right direction? You have a great rewinding lever to work with. It's really big for this little camera, and it just makes everything just easier to operate, you know, with this camera, given that it's the body is so little. It's really a kind of a cool concept, the way they engineered this camera to put those big parts on it to make it that much easier to use. All right, so this item right here, this is the release to open up the camera back. And what happens there, as you can see, the whole camera back comes off. And you can see the internals there that lock the back into the body of the camera. All right, and that is your film flattening plate, you know, the film plate. And you can see these leaf springs here that ensure that there's adequate pressure to make the film nice and flat. You can see the back element of the lens there. Right up in here is a cap that you can unscrew, like with a nickel or a penny or something, that holds the PX625 battery, which is the battery that you use with this camera. Lasts quite a while, but you should always keep this camera in a case so the meter's just not constantly running, because the meter doesn't have an on-off switch. So if it's exposed to light, the meter's working. When it's in the dark, these type of meters don't really draw any current. So the battery could really last for quite a while if you keep it in the case. All right, so let's show you how to load film in this bad boy. If you look at the viewfinder here, it's basically a mirror. It's got a reflective coating to reduce flare, but it also serves as a mirror. So you can literally use this as a selfie mirror. If you got the arms long enough for the minimum focusing distance of 3 feet, my arms are barely long enough to do that. It's, you know, I don't know how practical it is, but the point being, you can see yourself inside the mirror here, right? You can see your reflection in the mirror, and it's pretty easy to spot yourself in there. And if you can't, I'll just wave my hand a little bit, and then I can see my hand moving in there, and I can see where I am in the frame. Am I putting myself in the center of the frame, or what have you? And it works really well. And this isn't the only camera that's got that. These coated viewfinders were pretty prevalent in a lot of these cameras of the era. So that's just an unofficial little thing that I do with my cameras if I ever do selfies with these film cameras. And I have. I paid $300 for this, and I paid $300 with a faulty shutter. Okay, the slow shutter speeds on this camera are on one system, and then the faster shutter speeds are on another system. The slow shutter speeds are known to break down a lot on these cameras. That's one of those things that's a big fault with them. Now, if you get one that's been CLA'd and the slow shutter speed's repaired, then you've got a camera that should be good for quite a while. You know, who knows, 10, 20 years, whatever. But this one, unfortunately, is not one of those cameras. It does have a problem with the slow shutter speeds. And all right, let's listen to this slow shutter speed. This should be 1/2 second. And there's no way that's 1/2 second, right? That's like more like 1/4, maybe even 1/8 of a second, but that's how, oh, okay, now it's doing that. That was 1/2 second. That's odd, hasn't done that before. I'm kind of glad I caught it on video. Huh, so it looks like this thing has repaired itself, because when I got it, it honestly was you know, doing like 1/4 second when it should have been like 1/2 second. This is bulb, so you can hear that, how that sounds. It's funny how you heard the gears there the first time. But anyway, it's an old camera. It's like 55 some odd years old. Kind of interesting that the slow shutter speed started working. And we'll see how consistent. Let's see, it went back to 1/4. Anyway, you get it. So there's a slow shutter speed issue, and that's, again, that saved me a couple of dollars, because this would be otherwise a $400+ camera. And I'm talking about a 35S. The SEs get up there in the mid fours to 500 pretty quickly. The Tessar, the 35Ts, also have a great lens. They're 3.5 maximum aperture lenses, but they're still really sharp, really good lenses. But they, you know, they're just going to be a little bit, they're going to cost a little bit less and let in a little less light, but not the end of the world. If we're doing a quick reality check here, it's fine, finely engineered, beautiful as this camera is, and it's, I'm feeling it's pretty light compared to this Canonet. Yeah, it's significantly lighter than like a Canonet, but this Canonet has, it cost about half, maybe less than half for a nice clean one. It's got a 1.7 maximum f-stop Canon lens, and there's others. My beloved Minolta Hi-Matic 7S2, same thing, you know, 1.7 max f-stop Minolta lens on that. So, and this has the better potential for bokeh, and both lenses are just absolutely phenomenal. It's a surprise how good this lens is on such a tiny camera. Usually these small cameras just don't have lenses that are as good. Now, this camera, where's my focus right there? This guy right here, the Minox, has a Leica design lens, which is a great lens. It is not as good as this lens. This one will take surprisingly nice photos. This one takes shockingly good photos. Shockingly good. Better than this, and I never would have thought that if I didn't actually, you know, compare them. Same thing with this guy here. And I'll slide this guy open. Same thing with this one. It's got a Zuiko lens, this Olympus XA. It's a Zuiko lens, which is a true Olympus lens. And it's a Zuiko D, I think it is. F, it's an F Zuiko. It's a six element lens here. But the reason there's so many elements in this camera, in this camera lens here, is because they had to do some optical sorcery to make the lens shorter than its own focal length, right? To make the lens so small, they had to, I guess, include extra elements in order to make that happen. But again, a fine lens, takes nice photos. You won't get the bokeh from this camera that you will on this camera. This one you can actually figure out bokeh because it's a 40 millimeter lens, which helps it blur out the background a little bit better. You can barely see there the depth of field scale. So, you know, if you know how those things work. It's, you put your camera on f8 and then it'll show you what's in focus from between the two eights on there, for example, on the depth of field scale. Now, focusing goes out to like 20 feet, so the camera's still focusing it at around the 20 foot mark. But if you if you're within 20 feet, then you have to purely do it by guess. All right, and it can focus as close as 3 feet. So, you know, that's going to be pretty easy to be out of focus because there's not a whole lot of, you know, give there. It's not a very forgiving distance. So what I have done, and I took some photos recently using this. This is a rangefinder. It's just an old school rangefinder. Usually these things will have like a hot shoe on it. This one doesn't. But they'll have a hot shoe that you can put it on your camera. And this, in the case of this, I guess it would be down here. But yeah, you can put it on your camera and then use this to focus. Of course, you still have to input the focus. So if you calculate 4 feet here, you have to put 4 feet on the lens. Obviously, it's not linked to the camera. But they're kind of cool and very useful. You can see there's two windows there. One is an orange window that projects the rangefinder focusing patch in the middle of this window. They're tiny little, tiny little window to look through, but it gets the job done. As soon as you can see the ghost image of something splitting up, then it's very easy to calculate focus. And I took a roll doing this on purpose, trying to create some bokeh with this lens, because this is a 40 millimeter f2.8 lens, and it has the potential for bokeh if you do things right. Now, what I did, in fact, was go out with this yellow filter that just happened to come with this camera. the yellow filter reduces the stops by 1.5. And this is a Rollei filter, and I just want to show you this up close. It's kind of a nice, neat little deal here. You see that? It's a Rollei filter, and it tells you right on the filter, minus 1.5 stops. So what that means is that it'll reduce light by 1.5 stops. So I came up with, 1/500th of a second, overcast day, not a bright sunny day. So that helped. The minus 1.5 stops from the yellow filter, and yellow filter is good for black and white film. As we know, it makes your skies darker by blocking yellow light. Anyway, I came up with the possibility to have a lot of photos with really good bokeh. The lens wide open at f2.8, 1/500th of a second shutter speed, the yellow filter on there, the slowish 100 speed film. And I had a nice out of focus background, and any shot that I got kind of close to it, you have to kind of get close. You can't, it's not, like a 10 or 15 foot shot, but if I did like a 3, 4, 5 foot shot, I got a nice out of focus background. So that's nice. Here is a lens hood that I got with the camera as well. It's a rubber lens hood that's been, squashed down so long, it's very hard for it to unsquash anymore. And this tiny little lens cap, 30.5 millimeter filters, and the other lens, the 3.5 Tessar, takes, I want to say a 29. I'll post it up here, but it's something like a 29 millimeter filter. So, and there are filters actually out there for these. The Rollei filters generally around $30 for a tiny little filter, but they're kind of hard to find. And there's, aftermarket filters that you can get for 10 or 15 bucks or something like that. So it is good that this camera actually takes filters. And in terms of like your creative opportunities, because this isn't just a classic point and shoot, it's got some advanced features. The fact that it has filter threads, that's an advanced feature. It's got a threaded shutter release here for a cable. You can put a cable release here, just the old school metal kind. Those are made differently, a lot of them. So just in the owner's manual for this camera, it says to be careful not to press it too hard, because some of those cable releases just push down too far, and then you run the risk of damaging the internals of the camera if you like really force it. The camera doesn't have a self timer, but back in the day they had these self timers that would also screw into these shutter releases and into the thread there, and allowing you to do a self-timer type of photo. It's just these little devices that they stick up here, and they got a little cranked up timer, and they were kind of neat. And in terms of the creative options, there's also the fact that this has bulb. Now with the bulb shutter speed, as we know, bulb, as long as you hold down the shutter, or the shutter will remain open. As soon as you let it go, it closes. This wrist strap has the same type of connection that you would see on a TLR or some other any other medium format camera. There, oh, got it. All right, so a little pressure from the thumb and this pops right off. It's a quick release, which is really, really handy. It snaps right on there with no problem. You see it's back on just that easily, and very strong. Never have to worry about this part coming loose. It takes a lot of pressure to open this up. So it's not a complicated camera to use. The only warning again would be, you're covering the metering cell, but then it doesn't really matter, because you're not looking through the viewfinder when you're doing your metering. You're looking down at the camera when you do your metering. And then once the metering is set, you're free to take your photo. And if you look again at where my finger lands, this finger in particular, right on the shutter speed dial, that tells you why it is that they put this release here. Because if I'm doing this all willy-nilly, it would be really easy just manipulating the camera to change this f-stop setting. So it's good that they engineered it the way they did, and by locking the f-stop dial in. And then the ISO is so clicky, there's just no way that you would change the ISO. It's very clicky, and it literally takes two fingers to rotate it. You can't rotate it with just one finger. So neat little pieces of engineering all the way around. You know, on this camera, it's a tiny, unassuming camera with some really phenomenal pieces of engineering and thinking that went into this. That's kind of like just an overview of the pluses and minuses. Again, great photos from this camera. I'm be happy to show those off. So there you have it, guys. This is the Rollei 35S. Go out and get one.